Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology, and today we are going to continue with the Bhagavad Gita series. We have reached the second chapter's 11th verse. We will start with the 11th verse today. So if you have not watched the earlier two verse, the videos, you please watch it. Otherwise, you may be clueless of what's going on here. And in the last verse, Arjuna, in the last two verses, in fact, Arjuna fell silent and he couldn't even speak a word. He was totally paralyzed. And Krishna is about to speak. And in this verse, which we will listen today, Krishna starts speaking. All right. And this is where the Bhagavad Gita actually begins. And yes, as usual, if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me, then please go down to the website down in the description section. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and you will not only find Him, you will also listen to Him today. All right. Om Agyanti Miranasya Gyananjana Shlakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. 11th verse of the second chapter. It's a very famous verse. Krishna starts speaking. Shri Bhagavan Vacha Ashochyanan Vasochastvam Pragya Vadamscha Bhashase Gatasu Nagatasumscha Nanu Shochanti Panditaha. This is one of the famous 108 shlokas from the Gita. It's very important. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha. Uvacha means to speak. So Shri Bhagavan, Krishna is speaking. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, while speaking learned words, he is speaking to Arjuna. While speaking learned words, you are mourning for what is not worthy of grief. Those who are wise lament neither for the living nor for the dead. Wow. The purport. The Lord at once took the position of the teacher and chastised the student, calling him indirectly a fool. Wow. Krishna is calling Arjuna a fool. The Lord said, you are talking like a learned man, but you do not know that one who is learned, one who knows what is body, what is soul. Alright, so this means that Krishna is indicating to Arjuna that you seem to be, in fact, it's sarcastic here. One who knows what is body and what is soul. So Arjuna is not aware of this apparently as of now. So that's what Krishna is telling. And one who knows this does not lament for any stage of the body, neither in the living nor in the dead condition. So Arjuna is not aware of this apparently. So Krishna is calling him a fool because the body is anyways going to perish ultimately. As explained in later chapters, it will be clear that knowledge means to know matter and spirit and the controller of both. Arjuna argued that religious principles should be given more importance than politics or sociology. But he did not know that knowledge of matter, soul, and the supreme is even more important than religious formularies. And because he was lacking in that knowledge, he should not have posed himself as a very learned man. As he did not happen to be a very learned man, he was consequently lamenting for something which was unworthy of lamentation. The body is born and is destined to be vanquished today or tomorrow. Therefore, the body is not as important as the soul. One who knows this is actually learned. And for him, there is no cause of lamentation regardless of the conditions of the material body. So what Krishna is trying to tell here? Krishna is trying to tell Arjuna that you seem to be very knowledgeable and you seem to have lot of insights on what should be done and what should not be done. So if you have watched the earlier videos in before this, what Arjuna was doing, Arjuna was giving different reasons why I should not fight, why I should not kill the Kurus, why this war is not essential, this will lead to things becoming even more worse than good. And all these reasons that Arjuna gives is because he's actually very learned and he's a very great personality. He's very compassionate. But there is one problem here. He knows of all these terminologies and all these principles and all these conditions of what will happen if this war is, if this war happens. But he is not aware of one very important principle here. I mean, he is aware, of course, but somehow because of his love for Drona, Bhishma and his cousins, he is not able to realize that fact. So what happens is he starts feeling that these people will be killed and they will not be there. But what Krishna is telling here is, you are mourning for what is not worthy of grief. Which means, at two levels we can understand this. He was lamenting for the body. Body means, like Duryodhan is in a particular body. Duryodhan is a soul who is in a particular body. So similarly, Drona and Bhishma are also in particular bodies. And the body will anyways perish one day. So therefore, there is no use of lamenting for the body, which will anyways perish even if you don't kill them. They will die one day. And that's what Krishna says here. Those who are wise lament neither for the living nor for the dead. Why? Now, why do they don't lament for the living or for the dead? Because the body is like already dead. So in a sense, the body does not die actually. So generally people say that he died, she died. This in a literal sense does not mean that part. Because see, when you say he, you are not referring to that person's body. You are referring to the soul who was occupying that body. And when you say he left, that is why they say, oh, he has left his body. She has left her body. So that means this he or she is indicating the soul in a literal sense. Okay. And left means the soul has gone and occupied another body. So it will never happen that the soul dies. And on the other hand, the body was never living. The body was never alive. The body was always dead. The body is dead, in fact, now. But because that spark of the soul resides in the body. Because of that, we always feel that as if the body is living. The body looks very attractive sometimes. The body speaks in a very eloquent manner. The body walks in a very tempting manner sometimes. But the body is always dead. So the situation of the body is like, it's like a house where nobody stays. So imagine if there's a house where nobody is staying from 1 year to year. Then what happens? There's dust and it's completely, there are spiders, there are cobwebs and it's such a mess there. So nobody likes to stay in that home. In that house, because it's full of garbage. So similarly, nobody likes to touch a dead body. So therefore, whenever somebody dies, if we go there, so there, when we return home, our parents will always tell us that, oh, you have gone to a house where there's a dead body, so now you must take bath. Or if you go to a crematorium, a smashan or a kabristan, we must take bath, all right? Because the body is now fully manifesting its contaminated state, which means that now that element which was giving that so-called life to the body is not existing anymore. And that's what Krishna is telling to Arjuna, that you are lamenting that you will kill all these people. But you have to understand that even if you don't kill, they will anyways die one day. So this should not hinder you from going forward and fighting, because fighting is your duty. These Kauravas, they are personification of evil. They have done all the nefarious activities which anybody can even imagine, any sane human being. Yes, they had given poison to Bhima when he was a child, very young. Then they had tried to burn them, including Kunti Devi in Varnavrat, that Lakshagra, everybody knows that. And then they have, you know, tried to disrobe Draupadi, insult her in front of everybody. Then they, before that also, they've done so much politics, especially headed by Duryodhana, then his Mama Shakuni, then his best friend Karna, then his best brother Dushasan, Duryodhana company, DNC. There are two companies. One is DNC and the other is RNC. Which DNC? DNC is Duryodhana company. He and his close intimate associates. And RNC is Ravan and company. Ravan, Kumkaran, Indrajit, Prahast, Atikai, yes, Durmukh, Akampan, Trishira, all these Ravan and company. So these two companies had fully established their entrepreneurial spirits, and their business was growing quite far in distant lands, maybe up to the heavens also sometimes. But Lord Vishnu had taken incarnations and wiped these two companies out. All right. So Krishna is telling him that there is no use of lamenting for the body, because the body is actually never living and the soul never dies. So it's very simple, but sometimes it becomes very complicated to understand that how is that the body which is actually dead appears as if it is living. So I gave you the example of the home, the house. When somebody stays in the house, maintains it, it looks good, it looks clean. When somebody doesn't maintain, then the house becomes rotten and nobody stays there, nobody likes to go there. So similarly is the situation of the body. So now in the future verses, Krishna will tell why we should not lament for the body. Now, of course, this does not mean that we become irresponsible and we say that, anyways, you know, the body is dead, I will not maintain it. No, it's not like that. Krishna is not indicating irresponsibility here. Krishna is not telling Arjuna that, now, Krishna could have told Arjuna, anyways, I mean, now if you take this argument and turn it towards Krishna, that, oh, anyways, I mean, Krishna is telling Arjuna that you fight. But if, I mean, Arjuna is not the body, then who will fight? Yes. So once what happened in a spiritual community program, in a satsang when I went, then one of my senior gurus, he was giving a lecture and he said that you are not this body, you are spirit soul. So one of the members from the audience went and asked him a question. So Guruji, very nice, you told I am not this body. So whose body am I? He asked. I am not my body, then whose body am I? Then the guru said, no, you are nobody's body. You are not a body, you are soul. You are occupying a body temporarily, and because of you, who is living, who is par, who the soul is Satchit Ananda, full of eternity, full of knowledge, and full of bliss. The soul never dies. Nahanyate manhanye mane sharire. That shloka is there. Nayanam chindanti shastrani, nayanam dahati pavakaha. All these shlokas will come, don't worry. So this means that we should not be overly attached to the body. Alright, so many times people, they get so much into depression by thinking what will happen, that they are aging, you see. Their age is increasing. Now as if that's a new phenomena which has started. No, that's happening from millions of years, from the time the material world was created. Aging is a process. Aging always happens. It happens for everybody, for you, me, our parents, our children, or whoever. for every species, for trees, for anything in life, anything in this material world undergoes aging. So there are sometimes people, they will spend thousands and millions and billions of rupees sometimes to pretend that they still look young or they still look beautiful. Why to waste so much of the resources? Because either ways, if you are at 60 and you look as if you are 40, by the time you'll be 80, you will anyways look as if you are 60, right? So then you finally look like 60. May not be at 60, but at 80 you look as if you are like at 60. So now we maintain the body. Whatever is required, we do for maintaining the body. Because without maintaining the body, if we do not eat food, then we cannot maintain this body. The body, body will die, perish. The dead body will die. Yes. We have to work, we have to have a family, all these things we have to do. These are minimum requirements for the body. Whatever is required to put the soul and the body together, we have to do that. But we should not be overly attached. Oh, this will happen. This is my home. You know, this is my I, me and mine, basically. So basically, that's what Krishna is indicating, that Arjuna, you are thinking that this Bhishma and Drona, they are your elders, but no, they are not your elders, because your entity, your identity is limited to your dynasty. Like Bhishma is from your dynasty, so you are thinking, but actually Bhishma is from nobody's dynasty, because Bhishma, he is a soul, and due to his karma, temporarily he took birth in the Kuru dynasty. And actually Bhishma is somebody else. We all know who he is. But the thing is, Arjuna, because of his conception that, oh, I am a descendant of, I am Kuru Vanshi. Yes, I am a descendant of Kuru. That is why I am, and Bhishma is also one of the descendants of Kuru. And he is elder to him. Two generations. In fact, two and a half, but technically two. So he thinks that, oh, how can I kill Bhishma? That's Arjuna's mistake. And Arjuna gives so many reasons, but Krishna tells to him that you are such a fool who is giving such reasons. Now, this does not mean that Arjuna is a fool, but it means that Arjuna knows so many other things, that but he is not able to see the bigger picture. Okay, and that is why Krishna calls him a fool. Krishna says that, although you are speaking learned words, so Krishna is acknowledging the fact that Arjuna is very learned and he is a very great personality. Okay. The mourning, you are mourning of what is not worthy of grief. Why is it not worthy? Because of two reasons, I said. One, because the Kauravas do not deserve to live. They deserve to be killed because they are pillars of sin and irreligion and adharma and all the wrong activities. And secondly, they are... The bodies will anyways perish one day, right? So because of these two reasons, it is not worthy of grief, okay, what he is mourning about. So, and in the next verse, Krishna starts speaking even further, okay? The next verse is really long and really very interesting. And I can't wait to start the next verse in the next video, all right? So there you go. We finished this verse and we will very soon start. Now the core part of the soul and the Bhagavad Gita starts, all right? So, thank you so much. If you are new to the channel, please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation, please go down to my website down in the description section, okay? God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and listen to him also from the Gita, okay? Thank you very much.